Holy shit, have you watched Brian's JVMLS talk about Project Valhalla? It blew my mind. How Valhalla reached the peak of complexity and is now seeing the virtuous collapse. How surgical the changes to the program model might be. So cool. I know many of you have watched it, but I also know that not many of you have watched it to the end. So today we're going to distill the proposed program model, just the parts that we would interact with daily, into a short and sweet 10 minutes. A recap for the attentive, a hell of a ride for everybody else. Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Palok, Java Developer Advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to talk about the current state of the draft proposal for value types in Java. And when I say draft and proposal, I mean it. This is not a done deal. This is not how it's definitely going to be, and it surely isn't something that's going to happen in the next months or so. So we're not here to discuss how you'll program Java in 2025. We're here to look behind the scenes of an ongoing project. Deal? Then let's dive right in. Java's reference types and primitives are different, very different, and value classes are something of an in-between that would allow us to create primitive-like types with most of the comfort and expressiveness of regular classes. Hence the slogan, codes like a class, works like an int. So before we go into the current state of the draft proposal, let's list those differences and then we can work through the list to see where value classes land. For reasons that will become clear in the next section, I refer to the regular classes we all know as identity classes. So most obviously, identity classes can be user-defined, but primitives can't. Identity classes have members, methods, supertypes, etc., and primitives don't. Identity classes have a flexible construction protocol, whereas primitives have reasonable defaults and are usable without initialization. Identity classes have an object header and are referenced by pointers, whereas primitives are dense, meaning no headers, and flat, meaning no pointers. References are always written atomically, but primitives larger than 32 bits technically don't have to, even though they all are on modern hardware. Identity classes are nullable, can be used as parametric types and generics, and, as the name suggests, have identity, whereas none of that applies to primitives. Okay, time to get going, and since I apparently like saying identity a lot, let's start there. Instances of classes as we know them all have identity, some inherent quality that identifies each instance even as it may change its value over time. Two lists may contain the same objects, but that doesn't make them the same list. Two capital I integers may both be 5, but can still be distinct instances. And those distinctions are important when one of the instances is mutated, locked on, or a series of other so-called identity-sensitive operations is executed on it. While maybe not under that name, most programmers are deeply familiar with that concept, as it underpins the equals-equals comparison, because that checks for identity. At the same time, we know that this concept doesn't apply to primitives. Can there be two different ints with value 5? No, even the question barely makes sense. And as per the draft proposal, the classes that answer that question with no can be marked as value classes with the modifier value. So value class point or even value record point. First and foremost, this is a semantic statement that types like that don't need identity, which means they're immutable in the sense that their fields are all final. Identity-sensitive operations cause errors at compile or runtime. If they're a concrete class, they're implicitly final, and if they're an abstract class, yes, abstract value classes, think of number for example, they must not depend on identity. And that's pretty much it. As proposed, value classes can have arbitrary fields, multiple constructors, methods, they can implement interfaces, and even extend abstract value classes, codes like a class. Note that they're also reference types. We'll come to the memory layout later, but you should not think of value as a synonym for flat. Say it with me, it's a semantic statement. And one that will be applicable to tons of classes that don't need identity, including a lot in the JDK. We'll probably see the 8 primitive wrappers, optional, and many types in the daytime API become value classes. There are more details on all of this in JEP 401, and you can even try out value classes today with the most recent Valhalla Early Access build. But since things can still change, I'd rather wait for a deep dive until the JEP is targeted to release. Instead, let's move on to nullability. When I first read this on a mailing list a year or so ago, it blew my mind. The current state of the draft proposal coming out of Project Valhalla includes nullness markers. You know those question marks and exclamation marks, also called bangs, you put behind a type name? I didn't think that was possible. In fact, I'm on the record saying just that more than once. But I'll never be as happy for being proven wrong as I will be over this. So, under the current proposal, a variable of type string question mark can contain a string or null, whereas string bang cannot be null. A blanket string variable would be of unknown nullness. Think of it like a raw type for nullness. Again, I don't want to go into details here. There are two JEP drafts, one for null restriction of identity classes and another for null restriction of value classes that do just that, although they're not entirely up to date with recent developments. Instead, I want to focus on what may not seem overly consequential, but turns out to be very important for us here, and that are default values and initialization. First, let's observe that since the primitive wrapper classes are already identity-less value classes as per the previous section, it's mostly just nullness that sets them apart from their primitive counterparts. For example, integer can be null, but int can't. And so an integer bang, which cannot be null, is really very much an int, even though not quite, but we can ignore the remaining differences today. For now, think of primitives as the legacy version of integer bang, float bang, etc. One thing these specific null-restricted types all have is a good default value that fields and variables can initialize to. Integer bang has 0, boolean bang has false, etc. But what would a variable or field of type string bang be initialized to? Null sounds wrong given that the type explicitly forbids this. Variables are fairly straightforward, as definite assignment analysis can ensure we write a value before reading the variable. For fields, the unexpected save comes from Amber's exploration of more flexible constructor bodies, which previews in JDK 22. I made a whole video about that, but the summary is that under that proposal you can have statements in the constructor before the eventual call to another constructor with this or super, as long as those statements don't touch this.
I told you, homeboy, you can't touch this.
Well, actually, you can, but just to assign fields. No instant method calls, for example, in this so-called pre-construction context. It seems like this relaxation of the construction protocol will be immediately exported by Valhalla, which requires us to assign all null-restricted fields in that pre-construction context. That means null-restricted fields will actually be null for a few statements, but no code will ever be able to observe that. That, the definite assignment analysis for variables, and a kind of array constructor that I'll also skip here, means that we can declare non-null variables, parameters, and fields of all types and array types without a type having to be prepared for it. That means a soon-to-be value class like localDateTime, for which no good default value exists, can still be used for null-restricted fields. And this is essential for the next difference between identity classes and primitives. Okay, so let's talk about the memory layout. Primitives like int and double are simple bit patterns, flatly embedded in fields, the stack, or registers. Identity classes, on the other hand, are reference types, meaning each instance sits in a unique memory location on the heap and has a bunch of header bits for identity-sensitive operations. Parameters, variables, and fields reference it by pointer. Or at least that's the illusion the runtime maintains. If analysis shows that an object doesn't escape a certain scope, the runtime can do really nasty things to reduce the negative performance impact of headers, indirections, and heap allocations. And the same applies to value classes. Technically, they're reference types, and that's how we should think of them. But because the runtime doesn't have to track their non-existent identity, it can be even nastier to them. It can, for example, at any time decide not to represent a value object as a reference type on the heap, and instead shred it into its fields and keep them on the stack. It can also embed a value object directly in a field or array, thus removing the indirection of a pointer. And the memory layout is also where nullability comes back in. If a value class wraps a numeric primitive, say a long, then all 2 to the power of 64 bit patterns are already used, and if a variable of that type could be null, a 65th bit is required, which will balloon to 128 bits in total on all modern hardware. So by marking a field or array type as non-nullable, we give the runtime the information it needs to remove that extra bit that became 64 bits. Taken together, the runtime can give us primitive-like performance for non-nullable value objects and even a pretty decent speed-up for nullable ones. I want you to pause for a moment and let that sink in. We would get custom primitives with great performance as a consequence of good domain-driven decisions for our types, identity requirements, and our variables' nullability. And all we'd need to learn for that is how to wield the new keyword value, how to use question mark and bang, and how to order constructor statements. That's crazy! I want those things even without any performance gains, and we get those on top? I'm at a loss for words. Okay, let's go back to our list of differences and see where the proposed value classes fit in. As discussed, they're identity-less like primitives, but can still be null, although thanks to null-restricted types, they won't always have to be. The memory layout is technically that of an identity class, but the runtime has a lot of leeway to optimize all the way down to the density and flatness of primitives. We didn't get to atomicity, and even Brian's talk is very scarce on details here, but suffice it to say that value classes will probably have atomic load stores by default, but can opt out of that if they want the performance gain. All that's the works like an int part. As for codes like a class, just like identity classes, value classes can be user-defined, have members, methods, supertypes, and a flexible construction protocol. And since they're technically reference types, they'll work just fine with generics, and so will their null-restricted variants. So for a custom value class complex number, we can have a list of complex number bang, and then likewise, we can also have list of integer bang, which is basically list of int. As per the current draft proposal, this is how we'd get generics over primitives, namely as generics over null-restricted primitive wrappers. There are plans for how the runtime can flatten them so that the backing array of an array list of complex number bang or array list of integer bang can contain primitive values instead of pointers, but that'll probably come after the language changes. And I can't wait for that to happen. When? Don't check the comments. I'll definitely not leave my guesses there. Billy will be here in 2 weeks. I'll see you in 4. So long!